build a lot of custom interfaces, work with a lot of circuits, switches, sensors, and have people play usually face to face. I also have, so my history with Eyebeam is quite long. I was a fellow here starting in 2010 to 12, and then I became a computational fashion fellow, which was a fellowship for faculty, which is a fancy name for wearable tech. And then since then, I've done a lot of educational stuff, and actually starting with my fellowship, I started making these different kind of workshops and really finding sort of my voice within the world of sharing and becoming a teaching artist. And so I wanted to talk about that between today and also have you glimpse at, take a glimpse at this workshop that I've taught in the past that I feel like sort of there's a lot of things that I achieved with it tried to achieve with it that I want to share with you. This is really the reason why I make the work that I do, this kind of moment between people, they're wearing these hats that are embedded with like a wireless video camera and a wireless hex, wireless doorbell system, right? And with an arcade button on top. It's like this game, it's called Pit Game. You hit the other person on their button, and when you do, your camera takes a snapshot, and it's played within this like really small sort of sometimes 8-foot diameter circle. So the game itself can be really intense, right? And the purpose of this is I wanted to show that still use technology, but really have this like really intense face-to-face interactions, right? And like coming from a place where people play Street Fighter a lot and get excited about Street Fighter, like this was my physical version of that. This kind of spark that happens between people in these kind of situations, where I feel like my games are sort of this base, and then a lot of things happen on top of that, and that's kind of really exciting for me to see. And that's why I make these kind of games. This workshop that I want you to look at today is a human chain workshop that I taught at the Incubate Festival in Tilburg, Netherlands in 2016. So we're gonna do that. We're gonna go over the content of that today a little bit, and then I want to sort of go back, step back and talk about being teaching artists and what these kind of opportunities to share have to do with that. Hopefully we can discuss that. Eyebeam is really a great opportunity, and I mean it doesn't even have to be Eyebeam, right? It can be just different ways that sharing the methodologies that you use or the tools that you use with different people can really open up your practice as an artist in wonderful ways. We're going to actually do parts of the workshop today in a really condensed version. Another thing is that this festival was, it was an art and games festival, so there's a lot of media art, but also there's this whole arcade area. So a lot of the people who attended the conference were also game designers, independent game designers, or people who have a lot of, who are interested in games. Just keep in mind that we're approaching this from that point of view. Maybe this whole concept may not be new to you specifically, but it is meant for people to sort of step out of the world of playing console games, like games on PC, really really understanding what it means to make these kind of physical games. So for the next 10 minutes, I would like you to choose a partner. And I'd like you to think about, discuss, and list different kind of hand gestures, scenarios, and moments that the hands are touching. So, you know, anything from like high fives or to things like, when I think of scenarios, I think of like when I was a little kid, I grabbed somebody's hand and thinking it was a parent or something, and then when I woke up, it was my mom. Just like fear, right? And like, oh my God, what have I done? Like those, I'm talking about those kind of things. I want you to think about not just this, but like what is the context of these hands, you know, touching. Another example that I had was, I like to play this game like, while you're waiting for the subway or the bus or something with your friends, where you can just like, you hold your hands out and they hold, you put their hands on top and you try to slap the back of their hands. It's really easy, like children's game, but can bring, you know, many minutes of fun while you're waiting for the bus to come. And so things like that even. So I'd like you to think about, and also include the social context, the physical context, and the roles of the people involved. Are other people watching you play the hand slapping game, or you know, are your friends waiting to play with you? Things like that. So I just want you to do kind of a brain dump of that and write as many things down as possible. The whole brainstorming part of this exercise. I want to talk about now technology being sort of a supporting factor in the ideas that you've written. So technology as support rather than technology as the center of interaction. There's a couple of different ways that we can start talking about that. I chose a couple of those ways that we can sort of look at. So technology and interaction, some questions that you can ask about that is, you know, what is the interaction, or in game design we call it mechanic, and what is the interaction, and what is it between? Is it between the people? Is it between the person and the interaction? What is the result of the interaction? So what is it that you want to happen after they interact in a certain way? What is the role of the technology in the interaction? Is it all technology? Maybe it's like a mixture of physical and then also digital. Maybe that there's, there's a lot of room to play there between those kind of things. We know that there's a lot of games that you can play without technology involved. But then when you put in the technology, what is the role of that? How reliant is the interaction on the technology? So how important is the interaction to the technology? Oh, do you know what this image is from? It's from Demolition Man. and this is like the sex scene from Demolition Man when they put on these, I don't know, this kind of brain in their face. And they're having sex here. But yeah. Okay, and then like, you know, maybe technology is a judge. And then what is the value to making an experience, a game, or a game fair, right? Like in a lot of game experience is important. If the other person, if you know that the other person's gonna win from the very beginning, then why do you play, right? So a lot of times that can, or if you remember playing as a kid, like card games and, you know, your sister cheats, like, why even play? And is technology unbiased? Is it biased? There was even an MIT Media Lab research group that made a prototype of this interaction, this interface using like cheap cell phone parts and such. But really for me, in this scene, it was actually video editing memories, right? traveling through different memories, and it's like, who wants to video edit with their arms in the air? But you know, people loved it nonetheless, even though it makes absolutely no sense to think about it, right? But this idea that, you know, people don't know and therefore it's like magical, right? Like, these are all different ways in which technology can exist in your project. And you know, there's more than, way more than this. I just wanted to point out a few ideas. We're going to quickly sort of set up the Arduino circuit here, actually. And do people have Arduino, the IDEL, on their laptops or anything like that? I didn't really ask for it, so. And not everybody has to have it. So. Oh, no. Okay. So who has
I have to have it on.
Oh, but you have to have it on. Okay. So for people. And so I am going to, you know what, we're going to set up the circuits anyway, and whoever does not have the Arduino IDE on their laptop is fine. I want you to experience the cool experience of setting up the circuits. So come up from your group, one person come up from your group and grab an Arduino here. You might not. Go ahead and grab one here. I would like you to also grab a USB cord tonight. So again, we're just going for the feeling of it rather than taking the whole task.
And this crazy work?
Yeah.
But like, are you a composer?
You know, a lot of my project. Yeah. It's a great prototype tool. You know, eventually you can actually take the chip off and use it as a standalone circuit if you add like a clock and a couple of those capacitors to it. And also, it's great because it's just really versatile. It'll shut off if you're recording something. But on top of that, it's also open source hardware, so people. Many versions of the Arduino, and because it's open source, there's like huge forums, a lot of people share information about this tool. And so, especially for youth and adults, and anybody who wants to keep on learning after workshops, this is such a great tool because there's so much information online. And once they master the Uno, which is pretty much most basic model of the Arduino, they can really start looking at other tools that are more specifically designed. So in elementary school, you might have had exercise in science class where you made a circuit and lit a light bulb with a battery. And then when you broke the circuit, when you detached the wires, then you saw the light go off. And making and breaking the circuit is very much a basic part of the way we interact with electronics, actually, and so with technology. So when you turn off the light switch, when you turn off the light with the switch, you're essentially breaking a circuit. When you turn it on, you're creating that circuit, and that's how the technology knows what you want. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and make this. I know that email of this slide was also sent to you. You need some things close up. One last thing. I want to talk about breadboards. So this is not the kind of breadboard that you have here. But these breadboards are essentially prototyping boards that allow people to make circuits without soldering them. And this breadboard here that we have is more like just the center portion of these kind of breadboards. So when you flip it around, you can't see because there's a piece of paper on the back. But if you were to lift that paper, you would see these metal sort of rods connecting these five holes here. And then on another row, there's a different metal piece that connects the five holes here. So essentially, when you put wires into these holes, if they're on the same row, although it's only on one side of the, so it's always the five holes. If they're on the same five hole group, that means that they're attached, and or they're conducting electricity, and so instead of, you know, connecting wires, twisting them, or maybe soldering them, we can use the breadboard to essentially connect two different kind of wires together. So just know that these five holes on the left or the right, these five holes are connected together. With that in mind, we're just going to create this same diagram here with the components. This particular one is your capacitor. This is one of your resistors. I think I asked actually for the wrong number of the resistor, but you'll be able to differentiate them, this brown, black, red. And then this one is orange, white, orange. And although we don't have as many holes as in this breadboard, just imagine that the shorter breadboard sort of would exist like around here. Does that make sense? And I'll go around helping people, but essentially I just want you to sort of have the experience of setting this up. You may have not gotten an extra one of these. Brown, black, red. So since the rows are the ones that are connected, those are the important ones to keep on the same row. Otherwise, the number of rows in between this row and this row can be smaller than on the diagram. Again, the more you learn about the Arduino, the more sort of different things that you can pull out of your hat and use for any kind of project. But this is an approach that you can take where the human interaction is really the center of the project and not so much the technology. But the technology, of course, has to. This is just some of the technical stuff we went through. Sorry, that I'm sure. And this is a couple of slides about the circuit and how the circuit exists, this concept exists in all these different things that we interact with on a daily basis. And that's it. Thanks. And actually, I wanted to talk a little bit about then. Okay, so this is the end of that workshop. It's a much longer workshop usually, so you can really work with combining those ideas with the technology when I've taught it before. It's a longer span of time. But I wanted to show this workshop because for me this was one of the most exciting workshops that I've done recently, and it's because I was able to sort of communicate, even though we did like really technical things, I was able to communicate within a short period of time this approach of like really thinking about, okay, what would happen if I just thought about the human interaction first, and then if I were to then build that technology that supported that interaction. And I feel like this is kind of what resulted from that. And it's such a big part of, you know, my practice. And a lot of the classes I teach, especially the longer ones, the after school program and the ones that happen at the university, the whole semester or the whole program is based on just getting people to understand all the different things that the Arduino can do. And then at the very end, you know, without any tech, come up with an idea and then using the tech as support, right? And for me, this workshop was sort of like a condensed version of that. And I felt happy about it. But yeah, so I guess in a lot of ways, I just wanted to show sort of these ways that you can continue to, like, all of these things are experiments to me. Like, there's nothing that obviously I want people to walk away knowing something new. But in many cases, this is kind of an extension of the creative process for me. Like, when I come up with different kind of workshops or different content for classes, and I've been able to find that through Eyebeam, especially the opportunities that Eyebeam has given me, to really find the creativity and the playfulness within that, and sort of being able to extend my creativity and knowledge as an artist to the classroom, whether it's informal or formal. And so, yeah, so I guess that's the conclusion of the workshop. And if you have any things that you want to talk about or questions, I'm open.
Thanks for participating.